So today lecture is about the imaging extended targets. From multistatic response matrix. Multistatic measurements. So we have a target, electromagnetic target. It's with electromagnetic parameters as usual, epsilon star, mu star. This is permittivity, this is permeability. We have our array of receivers. I can make it here actually. This is array of receivers. And we have an array of transmitters. Could be the same or could be different. So let's assume that the array of transmitter is the same as the array of receivers. So if the arrays are englobing the target, then I'm talking about this full view setting, but it could be a limited view setting. So the array is not englobing the target. So this is one situation. The other situation is our array is here. It's distributed, and we can see the target from any angle. Okay, so this one is full view, and this one is a limited view. The setting is limited view. Okay, so we are sending electromagnetic waves and collecting the multistatic response matrix, MSR. Matrix, and from this MSR matrix we would like to make imaging. So what I did until now is assuming that the target is small compared to the wavelength. So this was one. The target characteristic size of the target is small compared to the wavelength. Okay, and we did this detection, localization, and we did detection, localization, and reconstruction. So detection using detection tests, localization is using imaging function, I introduce this subspace imaging, and topological derivative imaging, or least squares imaging. Maybe let's make it topological derivative. And the reconstruction, it depends on the signal-to-noise ratio. If the signal-to-noise ratio is high, then you collect the generalized polarization tensors, and then you make either matching algorithms or identification in some dictionary. But it needs a high signal-to-noise ratio. If not, then you reconstruct only the first polarization tensor. It gives you something. First polarization tensor. It gives you the equivalent ellipse. Okay. The low frequency information about the target. Low frequency. information about the target. Target check. Okay, and this is if you don't have enough signal to noise ratio. Okay, so this was what we did until now. Okay, so detection is this is a statistical test. And here we are talking about the optimality of the algorithms in the sense of stability and resolution. And as I said, there is always trade-off between stability and resolution. If you want to make the algorithm very resolved, then you lose stability. If you make it stable, then you will lose resolution. Okay. And for this GPTS, this matching algorithm, I said that it's a hopping algorithm, which make this trade-off optimal between the resolution and stability. You don't solve the optimization problem with both low frequency and high frequency information. You start with low frequency information, you get something, and then you use it like initial guess, and then you make the optimization on the high frequency part. This is high frequency part. This is low frequency part. So if you make the optimization over the low frequency part and the high frequency part, then you will be stable, but you will lose the resolution. If you start by making the low frequency part, optimization on the low frequency part, and then get image, and use this image to make it for higher frequencies, then this would be better. Okay. So this was what we did for multistatic response matrix. Of small inclusion, when the inclusion size of the inclusion is smaller than the wavelength. Okay. Now, what's going on when the size of the inclusion is larger? Size of the target is much larger than the wavelength. Okay. There is a fundamental difference. If you look at the multistatic response matrix, this matrix, and you do its singular value decomposition, you will see that the singular value decomposition of this matrix, if it's obtained in the presence of a small inclusion, has very few information. Few significant, again, values or singular values. And we know that the singular values, we know how they are associated with the target. So the first singular values are actually the eigenvalues of the polarization tensor, up to some constant, as functions of the polarization, the eigenvalues of the polarization tensors. The first eigenvectors are these eigenvectors we used for localization, are the vectors of the fundamental solution, okay, at the location of the inclusion. So the structure is very clear, it's simple and very clear when this target is small. Now, if the target is extended, and you do the SVD, you will see that you have many significant singular values, and all of the significant singular values contain information about the target. And if you want to do image, you have to understand who is associated to what. Who is here? useful. Okay. So this first taken value is associated to what? Second one is associated to what? All of this is associated associated to what? Okay. So the structure, when the singular value, the structure of the singular value decomposition or the structure of the multistatic matrix for extended target is completely different from the structure of small target. It's much more richer. It has a lot of information. And the reason is actually, if you think in terms of physics, this inclusion, there are many wavelets inside the inclusion. Okay? Each part is contributing to the multistatic response matrix. And it's not linear. It's not just the multistatic response matrix. It's the sum of all of these targets of size one wavelength. You may think about that. This is you take the wavelength as a characteristic size, and you count how many wavelengths are inside the domain, or how many wavelengths are necessary to describe the shape of the domain. And then you say, okay, all of this will contribute together to the multistatic response matrix, because this is the resolution limit. Okay? If we divide it by two, then this will not contribute by itself. It will contribute with the other half. All the blocks of size one wavelength will contribute to the multistatic response matrix, to the significant part. And then you want to understand the interaction, because there are many, and how they contribute. So this is what I would like to show you today. So the structure of the singular value decomposition is much richer. So we have to understand a little bit all the information contained in the singular value decomposition of the multistatic response matrix, and then try to make algorithms. So for small inclusions, other than least squares, these algorithms are direct algorithms. There is no iteration. When you plot one of the functional, Kirchhoff, reverse time migration, music, there is no iteration. You take the data and you compute the function at search point. And then you take the maximum. And then that's all. There is no iteration. This is direct because the target is small. If the target is large, then you cannot make it direct. There are a lot of information in the singular value decomposition of the matrix. You cannot make it direct. So it has to be iteration. Or iterative. So you start with some guess, and then you try to optimize or minimize the discrepancy. Otherwise, it will not work. So it cannot be direct. And the reason is because almost all the singular values and singular vectors are significant. Okay. Okay, so in order to understand this, the structure of the response matrix for extended target, still we need asymptotics. Okay, it's very hard to understand who is contributing to what. Okay, so we need some asymptotics, and we do this asymptotics with respect to known situation. I assume that we have known situation. So a known situation could be a disk. The target is a disk. Large but large disk. Large compared to the wavelength. Then you know the structure. You compute the singular value decomposition of the matrix associated to this target, call it D, 0, you know, you can make it explicit. Okay, then the true target is perturbation of this shape perturbation of d0. If it's shape perturbation of d0 and the shape perturbation is with some small parameter delta, then you can linearize the problem. The SVD of A delta delta, you linearize the problem. And then you understand the structure. And you can design algorithms to reconstruct the perturbation. Because it's perturbation, then you can make the algorithm direct. Because it's perturbation, no iteration. Okay. If this perturbation is large, then you cannot make it direct. You have to linearize it. If it's large, it's a large deformation. It's, you cannot describe it by delta. It's large deformation of the disk. If it's large deformation, then you can start with the disk, d0, then perturb the disk, get d1, and then perturb d1, get d2, and then perturb d until dn, and dn is close to the d true. And how do you get d1 from d0? Just linearize the problem. This is linearization, and then you iterate in order to minimize the discrepancy between the computed multistatic response matrix and the true one, this one. Okay, so you make it the blue one, you make it iterate. So this is one linearization. I will be back to it. The other linearization is to linearize with respect to the parameters, not the shape. Okay? So linearize with respect to the parameters. Instead that you can do something like a Born approximation. You have complicated shape. But you know that, let's make it simple, there is no contrast of magnetic contrast, but there is permittivity contrast, and this permittivity contrast is order 1. Okay? Then you linearize the problem using Born approximation, and you can design direct imaging. I'll show you how to do it. Because you linearize the problem. The problem becomes linear. Linear with respect to the shape. Okay. Or linear with respect to the characteristic function of the domain. So linear. Okay, so in order to do this, let me start with inverse source problems. So inverse source problem is a first step. When you do Born approximation, you linearize the problem and you make it inverse source problem. So, let me show you how to do it. What would be the solution here? Let's write a Born approximation for this. So you have this, you start with Lippmann-Schwinger representation formula. So what's you have point source here, and you have your receiver here, and the solution is what? Is the green function k0 xy, okay, plus what? We can write it down. Okay, so the equation here is Laplacian plus omega square, let me write it, k0 square epsilon 0 minus 1 uy is equal to delta y. This is the equation on the field with uy satisfying the Sommerfeld radiation condition. Right? So if you compute Laplacian plus k0 square of uy minus the fundamental solution, which satisfies the Sommerfeld radiation condition, this is what? This is, so I write it plus k0 square plus this one. So you understand what I mean? So it's Laplacian plus k0 square epsilon star epsilon 0 minus 1 in, okay, let me write it more carefully. So it's Laplacian plus k0 square key outside of this D, put it in dimension 2, plus epsilon star epsilon 0 minus 1, the characteristic function of the inclusion ui delta y. You agree with this? Okay. Now if you compute Laplacian plus k0 ui minus the fundamental solution, you cancel the Dirac mass, but what you get, you get k0 square 1 minus epsilon 0 epsilon star over epsilon 0 uy. That's right. And you have uy minus gamma k0 satisfying the radiation condition. Then you have uy minus the fundamental solution is equal to k0 1 minus epsilon star epsilon 0, the integral of uy of z gamma k0 of x and z dz. And here you integrate over d, because this is compactly supported in d. Okay? So this is a Lippmann-Schwinger representation formula. Now I'm assuming that epsilon star epsilon 0 minus 1 is almost 0. Means what? Means that uy is very close to the fundamental solution. So here I will replace this one by the fundamental solution. This is very close to gamma y and z. So the Born approximation is to say that the solution of this problem is, let me keep it here, the solution of this problem, uy of x minus gamma k0 of y of x and y, this is approximately k0 square this guy, and the integral on d gamma k0 y and z gamma k0 x and z dz. Right? This is the approximation. Now what's the multistatic response matrix? The multistatic response matrix is of entry m. So you have this is yn, and you measure on xm. Okay? So it would be anm approximately k0 square 1 minus epsilon star epsilon 0, the sum on D, gamma k 0, y n d, gamma k 0, y x m d, d d. Now you have a better idea on what is the multistatic response matrix. If you write D like sum on DG, where DG are just you divide this D into pieces of size one the wavelength. Okay. The multistatic response matrix is nothing else than the sum of all of these contributions. Every point inside is contributing to the multistatic response matrix. Every block, every DG for G from 1 to N is contributing to the multistatic response matrix. Okay? And contributing by one significant singular value. So actually you can have a good idea on how many eigenvalues are significant eigenvalues are in multistatic response matrix. Or if you know the multistatic response matrix from the measurements, you can estimate the size of the target. Because the size of the target is nothing else than the here you will have let's say capital M significant eigenvalue, and capital M significant eigenvalue means that what? That is the domain D over lambda square. This is the number N approximately here, and this is approximately M. Actually, you can make it more precise. Okay, so the number of eigenvalues can give you estimate of the volume of D under this Born approximation. Good. I will show you if we don't have this Born approximation, but we have this magnetic inclusion, then what is contributing to the multistatic response matrix is not inside, but is the boundary. So the number of multi-significant eigenvalues would be the size of delta t over the over lambda. Okay, so this is for this case. I will go back to it. Okay. Now I'm justifying that. How to get d? So this is a problem. How to get d from a of omega? If it's fixed, if we have single measurements. Single measurements done at single frequency, then standard way is a diffraction tomography. I will explain it. If we have broadband measurements, omega is in some interval, let's say omega in 0 plus infinity, then we do the time reversal. So I will explain it. So if you have one frequency, you do diffraction tomography. If you have many frequencies, if you have a range of frequencies, you do time reversal. Okay, I will explain these two. And I will explain them for this problem. For this, I started with a target problem inclusion, but because of the Born approximation, I end up at inverse source problem. Okay. The source is what? The source is this is the source approximating when approximate. this one, I approximate this one by the fundamental solution, right? So this is source, and I measure the solution, and I want to estimate the source. This is now becomes source because of this Born approximation. It becomes source, and the problem becomes inverse source problem. So let's start with diffraction tomography. So no questions? So under the Born approximation, I reduced the inclusion problem to inverse source problem. And there are two problems, two reconstruction problems with reconstruction with single frequency and reconstruction with a broad range of frequencies. So technique here is diffraction tomography, and here, as I will explain, is the time reversal. And in some sense, they are optimal. Okay. So let's start by diffraction tomography. So what we have, I would like to make it a little bit more general. So this approximation, it comes from the fact that this difference is very small, right? But we can make it a little bit more general. So we can make this target. So assuming that epsilon star is inhomogeneous inside the target. Okay. It's epsilon zero, constant outside, and it's inhomogeneous. Okay, but it's close to epsilon zero. So it's epsilon star over epsilon zero of x. I assume that this is one plus some potential v of x. Okay, then I have exactly the same. I have uy of x minus gamma y gamma k0 of x and y. This is approximately k0 square, the sum on d, v of d, okay, gamma k0. So this is would be v, it would be on site because it's inhomogeneous. This is gamma k0 of x and g, and this is gamma k0 of y and g, and I integrate over dz, right? What we would like to get is we would like to get the Fourier transform of v from the Fourier transform of the measurements. From this Fourier transform of this, I will call this reflectivity function. Its support is the domain D. It's extended. It's large compared to the wavelength. And I would like to get its Fourier transform from the Fourier transform of the data. So diffraction tomography does this. It relates the Fourier transform of the potential to the Fourier transform of the data. Data is this one. Potential is here. and it relates the Fourier transform with this one to the Fourier transform with this one. Okay. So first of all, I will make one more approximation. I will assume that this y is the source, and x here is the receiver. I assume that the source is far away from the target. Y is far away from the target, so the spherical wave or cylindrical wave in dimension 2 will behave like you have a spherical wave and it's at infinity. You will see it like a plane wave. Okay, so cylindrical wave, to make it in cylindrical or spherical wave, cylindrical wave will behave like a plane wave. Spherical wave, it will behave like a plane wave. Let's check it. Spherical wave. So spherical wave is what? Let's do it in dimension 2. Three, it's easier. Ek0 y minus d over 4 pi y minus d. I said that y is very far from d. So y minus d, it can be approximated by what? Actually, you can write the formula. It's y square minus 2 scalar product between y and z plus z square. So this is y square 1 minus 2 yz over y square plus z square over y square. Okay, y is so this is y minus z square. So if you take the square root of this one, you will get the square root of this one. Okay, now y is very large. Then this and z is fixed. So you can neglect this one. Okay? And the square root here will behave like this one. So y minus z will behave like y minus y over the norm of y times z. Okay, so this spherical wave will behave like exponential ek0 y over 4 pi y, but this is a constant as function of z, times exponential minus ak0 y over y times z. And this is plane wave in which direction? In the direction y over its norm. Okay, well, this is plane wave and y over in this direction. Okay, so we are plugging this approximation. It's the same in 2D. In 2D, you start with h1 0 of k0 y minus z, and then you do the asymptotics. Because we know the asymptotics of the Hankel function, when the argument goes when y minus z goes to infinity, you plug in this asymptotic formula, and this asymptotic formula is the same. It's, the factor is different, so there is the square root of y here, but it doesn't matter. It's constant. It's independent of z. Okay. Okay, then you plug in this one here. So this would be exponential minus a y over y times z. Okay? And the other one, actually the other one, if you make the measurements far away, this one would be approximated by the same. This one would be approximated by a minus y x over K, there is k0 if the measurements are far away, then you have the same approximation. Okay, for the plane wave, for the spherical wave, cylindrical wave, you have the same approximation. Then this is what? This is nothing else than This is nothing else than this is nothing else than what? K0 constant sum on D VD exponential minus AK0 X over X plus Y over Y D DD. But this is what? This is Fourier transform. You call this variable Xi, you call it K0 X over X plus Y over Y. If Y makes a sphere or a circle is in circle, large circle around the target, and X is the same on large circle around the target, X over X and Y over Y, these are unit vectors, their sum would be what? Their sum would be inside this disk of size 2. So for Xi, Xi would be in the disk of size two K0. Is that right? So any vector inside is the sum of two vectors on the unit circle. Okay, and the sum of two vectors on the unit circle generate any point inside. Okay. Then this is in terms of the Fourier transform is what? So you have Xi here. You have sum on D, VD, exponential minus A, Xi, D, DD, and you have the value of this function. So because this is data for any Xi less than 2K0. So with this, how to get the V? You extend by zero. You extend this by extend in the variable Xi by zero outside, because this is you don't have data. For Xi larger than 2K0, you don't have data. So you extend it by zero. Let's give you. It's called the zero padding algorithm. And then take the Fourier, the inverse Fourier transform on Xi. Right? When you take the inverse Fourier transform on Xi, what you get? You get V. Or actually, you don't get V. You get V filtered. You get let's say you get low pass version of V. What's the low pass version of V? You don't get any high frequency in V. They are truncated. Okay, but you get all the low frequencies, you get them. Okay, any frequency up to 2K0, you will get it. So it's a low pass reconstruction, and this is with resolution, relay resolution. Okay, 2π/2K0 resolution, because you truncated all this frequency. Resolution is 2π/2K0. This is π/K0. This is the resolution of your image. So you truncate all the high frequency information. If V is oscillating here, it has a lot of oscillation, but amplitude is small, but it oscillates. Then these oscillations, you will forget about them because they are high frequency information. And the only thing that you can reconstruct is the low pass version of it. You can reconstruct the low frequency part. Okay. Now, this is your measurements when they are done far away. Okay. For x, I approximated x still by this one, by exponential. If x, maybe get rid of this. If x is not far away, in order to approximate, this approximation is not correct, replacing the Green function, the fundamental solution by just the phase is not correct, then you use a Bayley representation of the fundamental solution, which gives a plane wave representation of the cylindrical wave. So cylindrical wave, you can write it as sum of plane waves. If it goes to infinity, it's just one plane wave coming from the direction y over y or x over x. Okay? If it's and this approximation is Bayley representation of spherical or cylindrical waves. It says the following: gamma k zero of x and zero, so z is equal to zero. Or I don't know how to define the gamma. Okay, is equal to some constant, the sum on r d minus 1 over beta alpha, and I will comment this a beta alpha xd plus alpha x tilde d alpha, where beta alpha is equal to square root of omega square minus alpha square, for alpha smaller than omega, and it's equal to I square root of alpha square minus omega square if alpha is larger than omega. And these are constant depending on the space dimension, and x is equal to x tilde xd. So here you put x1 xd minus 1 and x tilde. What's this? You have a spherical wave. You have a spherical wave or cylindrical wave. It propagates like this, right? This is its origin. Propagates a spherical wave, and you want to write it like sum on plane waves. Plane waves, they propagate. They propagate like this. Okay. It says this is what you fix the direction. So whatever is the direction, you fix this direction. You fix this direction. Okay. You fix this the direction x, and the spherical wave is what is the sum. These are plane waves, exponential e beta alpha xd plus alpha x tilde. This is plane wave. So let's write it in dimension 2. This is exponential e beta alpha x2 plus alpha x1. Okay, it's plain wave. So x2 and x1, it's x2. So x2 is this one. X1 is this one. Okay, this is x1 and this is x2. Okay, why am I orientation? This is x2. Whatever orientation, x1. So this is x1 and this is x2. In this direction, x2. Look at how it behaves. So plane wave usually is if it's propagating without any exponential decay, it's a propagating wave. It's exponential. This is plane wave. What is this? This is plane wave. It propagates. It oscillates. Its norm is equal to 1. Okay. Look at this this one here. It's okay. It's plane wave. But for alpha larger than omega, it's beta alpha is getting I. So I times I will be minus. So it's exponentially decaying. So this plane wave is exponentially decaying. For all alpha, for alpha larger than omega, the plane wave there is a vanishing wave. Okay. It doesn't propagate actually. It propagates a few wavelengths and then exponentially decaying. It's zero. Okay? It's a vanishing wave. The others, if for alpha smaller than omega, these are propagating plane waves. So the cylindrical wave is the sum of vanishing waves plus propagating waves. It's not the sum of only propagating waves. Okay, sum of vanishing waves plus propagating waves. So if you are near this x, still you for x too small. For x too small, this exponential, this vanishing part will have a contribution because this is exponentially decaying, but xd is very small, so it's still of order one. But if you go further, then it's exponentially decaying. Okay. So if you have target very small, very close to here, then you can use the vanishing wave to image this. If the target is here, then you can forget about it. And this distance is in terms of the wavelength. Because for alpha larger than omega, and you have beta alpha is square root of omega square minus alpha square, okay, or alpha square minus omega square. So all the frequencies larger, all the frequencies larger than alpha, they cannot propagate. Okay, they cannot propagate few wavelengths after their generation. Okay, so this is the plane wave representation of a spherical wave, and then you plug it plug this into the assumpt expansion here, the Born assumpt expansion. Instead of plugging just plane wave approximation, you plug it's not approximation, this is formula exact. This is equal to the guy there. Okay, so what you end up with? You end up with something very similar to this.